that didn't mean that he was hard on rich people. That many of them hard were poor as well. And bringing this up is just sort of a prelude into a particular incident that occurred during the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. One of the famous Sahaba, Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah, was considered to be one of the 10 promised Jannah. He was given the task to oversee the tribute which would be collected from the people of Bahrain when the Prophet ﷺ had appointed him to that position. And in one particular day, he had returned to Medina with the tribute that he collected from the people of Bahrain. And on the following morning, at Salat al-Fajr, the Sahaba gathered, and many of the Ansar had attended that particular day, and according to the Hadith, many of the Ansar were those who were very interested in knowing what was available to take themselves back home, you know, as a result of Abu Ubaidah's return to Medina. And so this particular day was different in that typically the Prophet would do what he had to do, and then he would leave, and no one would bother him. But this particular morning, before he, as he was attempting to go back to his house, a number of the Ansar gathered around him, and they started to talk to him. They didn't say exactly what they wanted, but he suspected, the Prophet suspected, that there was something, some issue, or some need that they had. And he said to them, I think that you have heard that Abu Ubaidah has returned from the Bahrain. And then they confessed, said, yes, Rasulullah, yes, we have heard that, and we were interested in knowing what is it that we could gain access to of this particular wealth. And the Prophet, of course, doing as he would do, he would divide the wealth, but he told them in this particular instance, he says, Wallahi, man faqra akhsha alaykum, said, I swear to God, it is not poverty that I fear for you. ولكني أخشى عليكم أن تبسط الدنيا عليكم. That what I do fear for you is for this world to be laid before you, to be opened up and laid before you. In the Arabic language, the word al-bisat is a word for the a carpet, you know, because it rolls out. Right? That I fear that the dunya, this world, the worldly things, will be spread out for you, كَمَا بُسِفَتْ عَلَى مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ, as it was spread out to those who came before you. فَتَنَفَسُوهَا كَمَا تَنَفَسُوهَا, and then you will vie with one another for it in the same way that they vie for it. فَتَنَفَسُوهَا كَمَا تَنَفَسُوهَا, and it will destroy you in the same way that it destroyed them. It will destroy you in the same way that it destroyed them. And what's interesting in reflecting upon destruction is that destruction doesn't necessarily look like the loss of wealth, but the destruction that the Prophet ﷺ most likely was making a reference to was spiritual sort of degeneration or destruction, that people themselves become so attached to what they have and what they've been given of this world that they forget about what is most important. And if you read about the main mission, the main part of the mission of the Prophet, which was to reconnect the creation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with their creator, then that was his main mission, to reconnect us with our creator. Recently, a number of news outlets had reported that an annual income of $117,000 a year in the Bay Area, according to the Department of Housing and Urban Development, is now considered to be low income in the Bay Area. $117,000 per year is now considered to be low income. Some months ago, there was another report that had come out and said that more than 40% of all Americans now live or can't afford basic necessities. They say is on 51 million households in America, 43% of Americans not being able to afford basic necessities. Now, I bring this up to say that I necessarily accept the claims or to make it seem that our situation is so dire. But rather, it's to remind us that poverty is a relative term. Poverty is a relative term. And when they say that 43% of all Americans can no longer afford basic necessities, what they mean by that is middle-class basics, what they call middle-class basics, which are rent, food, childcare, healthcare, transportation, and cell phone. And so this is what is meant by it. Now, some people may hear that and say, well, that's pretty bad because you're constantly comparing yourself to people who can't afford those different things. And so because I can't afford those things, I must be poor. But when we, as Muslims, we look upon our situations and we reflect upon our lives and we reflect upon the conditions under which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed us, that we learn from our deen that one of the worst things we can do is to constantly look at those who are better off than we are when it comes to material possessions, when it comes to matters of this dunya. We're actually told that we should look at those who are worse off than we are. Because we have deluded ourselves, deceived ourselves into believing that we are truly poor. If you can't afford, for instance, when we think cell phone, nowadays cell phone is the iPhone. We're talking about Samsung, right? We're talking about things like that. Or there are really people who can't afford those different things. I come from a place where people, even still today, can't afford cell phones. I know people who can't afford to open up a bank account, even still today, right? Many of you may have never heard of something called the check cashing place, right? That some people, they get paid, when they get paid, they go to the check cashing place to cash their checks, right? I don't really see those in, you know, I haven't seen any of those in the Bay Area, right? But where I come from, you know, these are the type of people that we generally would place into the category of really being poor. But even these people, even many of these people, I lie to you not, many of these people themselves, from a basic Islamic standpoint, probably still would not fall into the category of being poor. And the reason for that is, when you'll find that there'll be these people who may not be able to afford a bank account, but at the same time, they can afford a home. Their refrigerators are full of food. Their shelves the cupboards are full, right? They have 2-3 televisions inside of their homes, right? They have furniture, right? So comparing them to people from a different country, well, people would think that they're living in luxury, living like kings, right? So poverty, remember, is a relative term. And I think we should not allow ourselves to be overcome with a type of hysteria when we read these type of things and remember and recall that the Prophet taught us that that if the son of Adam had 2 valleys of wealth and he would want a third, the only thing that will fill up the interior of the son of Adam is dirt. Meaning that the more we have, the more we want. It's never enough. You become a billionaire, it's not enough. You become a billionaire, it's not enough. Become a trillionaire, still probably won't be enough, right? If that is even possible, right? But that's just our nature. And we should not allow ourselves to be deceived by this. Once a man had come to Ibn Adham in the marketplace and complained that all the prices have increased. They become exorbitant. So Ibrahim ibn Adham responded to him, "Akfisuhu bitark." He said, "Cheapen those things. Cheapen them with abandonment. Cheapen them with abandonment. By the weakest legal, don't buy it. Just don't buy it." Because that's what happens quite often is that, I mean, the Sahaba themselves, you find that most of the Sahaba at one time actually couldn't afford to have more than one garment. It's like the Sahaba comes to the Prophet ﷺ one time and asks him, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, is it permissible for a man to pray in two garments and he doesn't have any on, like sort of like a cloak on top of him?" And then the Prophet ﷺ responded to him, he said, "Alikulikum, so man, that either you have two garments," right, to emphasize the very fact that the Sahaba were extremely impoverished people, very poor people. This is one of the basic reasons why in the Islamic law that men, if they pray with their shoulders exposed, that the prayer is still valid. It kind of because they gross up, and of course it still counts for us today if we were to do that, but definitely from the Sahaba. Think about your own situation. How many pairs of shoes do you have? How many garments do you have? Right? And I'm not just talking about the people who have a lot of wealth. We consider themselves and others who have more wealth than ourselves and have extremely a massive amount of wealth. But those of us who may not have billionaires, for instance, or those of us who may be struggling from check to check or have just a little bit of surplus every time we get paid, right? Like, how much do we truly have? The same thing with Ibn he spoke about another type of poverty that the seekers or those on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they consider to be a goal of life and faqr, the true type of faqr, of poverty, neediness, having a need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? That is to say that to overcome having an attachment for this world. So he says that the Lord Taqab that we sought poverty for Sakbalan al Ghina, but we were met with affluence. Wa Talab al Nasu al Ghina wa Sakbalan al, and the people themselves, they themselves sought to become affluent and they were met with poverty. Meaning that they were insatiated. That we sought, right, we pursued our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we think about everything that we encounter in our lives, in this world, in this country, and the different pursuits that we are taking part in, that at a certain point in our lives, is also especially if we are people part of national organizations, we have to ask ourselves sincerely, like, what particular contribution am I making to American society through my Islam, not just simply as an individual, as a citizen of America, right, but through my Islam, is there something special about my being that contributes to a better America? And I would say that one of those basic things is the spiritual tradition that we have, the spiritual tradition of Islam, which teaches us these type of things. That poverty is relative, and we are people who should never be obsessed with the dunya, that the fact that we may not have what others have should not become a sign to us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has abandoned us. But we also focus on the good. We focus on what we have, which may be more than what others have, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he grant us proper understanding, he grant us sincerity in all we do, and he grant us forgiveness for our sins. in the area of hadith, there is a certain type of hadith called hadith al-Qudsi, the divine hadith. And this hadith is defined as مَا كَانَ نَفْرُهُمْ عِنْدَ الرَّسُولِ وَمَعْنَاهُمْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. That is a hadith whose wording is from the Prophet himself, alayhi salatu wasalam, but his meaning comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, like other hadith, the hadith al-Qudsi can be sahih, hasan, da'if, or mawdu. It can be acceptable, it can be unacceptable, it can be fabricated, among other things. And then we have, sometimes the hadith al-Qudsi may not originate from the Muslim community, it may originate from the previous nations, Bani Israel. And there's one in particular, which is very fascinating, that I found recently, which is, the scholars would say that it doesn't have, and it's not in our tradition, and some of them believe that it originates from a man called Ka'b al-Ahbar. Ka'b al-Ahbar was a tabi'i, even though he's a man who lived during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, sometimes he was originally a Jew, and then became Muslim after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, and he joined the community, and he contributed greatly to Muslim understanding. Sahaba, Umar ibn Khattab, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abu Huraira, so many of them contributed to their understanding of the traditions of the Torah and the Injil. And this particular tradition, which is attributed to them by some, it reads as follows. And the reason why I say all of this, first and foremost, is that you have to be very careful. The Prophet ﷺ didn't say this. He didn't say it. None of the Sahaba said it. It's likely from Ka'b al-Ahbar, who attributes it, according to his narration, to the Torah. And Allah knows best that it comes from there. But I'm just reading it to you, in spite of all of that, because I believe it has great wisdom and many lessons, which are truths that are universal. So even if they didn't come from the Prophet, it comes from the Sahaba, or even perhaps come from Ka'b al-Ahbar, that it came from some wise person, right? And we have the right to benefit from that wisdom. But it's attributing these statements, this is as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing us, addressing his creation. He says, Ya ibn Adam, la takhafunna min bi sultan, ma dama sultani baqiya. He says, O son of Adam, do not fear any person in a position of authority, as long as my authority remains. وَلَا يَنْفَدُ سُلْطَانِ أَبَدًا. And my authority will never end. My authority, my sultan, will never end. يَا ابْنَ آدَمَ لَا تَخْشَ مِنْ ضَيْقِ رِزْقِي مَا دَامَتْ خَزَائِنِي وَالْآنَ. O son of Adam, do not fear from having your sustenance restricted, as long as my treasure chests are full. وَلَا تَنْفَدُ وَخَزَائِنِ لَا تَنْفَدُ أَبَدًا. And my treasure chests will never be empty. يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ لَا تَأْنَسْ بِغَيْرِي وَأَنَا لَكْ. O son of Adam, do not take solace in anyone other than me, when I belong to you. وَإِنْ طَلَبْتَنِي وَجَدْتَنِي. And if you seek me out, you will find me. وَإِنْ أَلِسْتَ بِغَيْرِي فُتُكَ وَفَاتِكَ خَيْرُ كُلُّ. And if you are to take solace in anyone other than me, then I will pass over you, and all good things will pass over you. يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ خَلَقْتُكَ لِعِبَادَتِي فَلَا تَعَبْ. O son of Adam, I have created you for my worship, so do not play. وَقَسَمْتُ لَكَ رِزْقَكَ فَلَا تَنْعَمْ. And I have divided a portion out to you for your sustenance, so do not wear yourself out. Do not burden yourself or create fatigue upon yourselves. وَفِي أَكْثَرَ مِنْهُمْ فَلَا تَطْمَعْ. And in most forms of sustenance, don't even seek out. وَمِنْ أَقَلَّ مِنْهُمْ فَلَا تَجْزَعْ. And if you receive a small amount of it, then don't lose patience. Don't lose patience. فَإِنْ أَنْتَ رَضِيْتَ مِنَا قَسَمْتُ لَكَ رَحْتُ قَلْبَكَ وَبَدَنَكَ. And if you are content with what I have apportioned out to you, then you will bring comfort to your heart and to your body. And you will be praiseworthy in my eyes. You will be praiseworthy in my eyes. He says, and if you are not content with what I have pushed out to you, then I will grant authority to this world and this dunya over you, and you will tire yourself out in the way that beasts of burden do, that the beasts of the jungle do so, and you will only achieve from it that which I have pushed out to you. And you're only going to get what Allah has already written anyway. And you will be blameworthy in my eyes. Yabna Adam, خلقت السماوات السبع والأرضين السبع ولا معي بخلقهن أجرنيني رقيب أسوقه لك من غير فعل. So, O son of Adam, I created the seven earths, seven heavens, and the seven earths, and I did not become weary from their creation. Will I then become weary from a piece of bread that I transferred to you without any type of fatigue coming to me? Ya ibn Adam, ana laka muhibbun. Ana laka muhibbun, O son of Adam. I love you. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. O son of Adam, I love you. Ana laka muhibbun. فَبِحَقِّي عَلَيْكَ كُنِّي مُحِبًّا. And by my right upon you, love me back. By my right upon you, love me back. يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ لَا تُطَالِبْنِي بِرِزْقِ غَدٍ كَمَا لَا أُطَالِبُكَ بِعَمْلِ غَدٍ. O son of Adam, do not demand from me the provision of tomorrow in the same way that I don't ask of you the work of tomorrow. My Allah wants to work today, now. Not tomorrow, work now. So I'm asking him for your sustenance tomorrow. It's going to come. For inni lan ansa lan asani. Because, why? Because I have not even forgotten the one who disobeys me. Forgive him and Allah. So how can I forget the one who obeys me? How can I forget the one who obeys me? Mu'ana ala kulli shayin qadir. And I have power to do all things, and I encompass everything, encompass knowledge of everything. So these things to reflect upon, again, it is not a worthy statement or a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it is a narration attributed to the Shaykh al-Sahib. It has great many truths in it, and full of points of reflection, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He make us among those who love Him. Make us among those who love Him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people who fulfill the covenant that we made with Him. Rabbana atina min ladunka rahmah wa hayyib lana min amrina rashada. Rabbana atina min ladunka rahmah wa hayyib lana min amrina rashada. Allahumma habibna ya Rahman. اللهم حبب الينا الايمان اللهم حبب الينا الايمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره الينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان وجعلنا ربنا الراشدين ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم واتب علينا انك انت التواب الرحيم اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الاحياء منهم والاموات واغفرنا اللهم معهم بفضلك واحسانك يا ارحم الراحمين. ربنا اتنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الاخره حسنه وقنا عذاب النار. وصلى اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه الاخيار. اسال تسليما كثيرا. سبحان ربك رب العزه عما يصفون. وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.